Let us pray. Lord God, our Father, how glad we are to come together and bow before you this morning in worship. You are the glorious Almighty God. You have indeed done marvelous things. By your own action, by your right hand and holy arm, you have brought salvation to your people through Jesus Christ, your Son. Salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb. Your justice is perfect and your grace is amazing. You have acted in your justice and grace and mercy in the death of your Son so that sinners can be justly forgiven and made right with you through faith in him. So as we come as those who have been redeemed and brought back to you, Father, through Jesus. We worship you, we thank you, we declare your glory, we worship you. We rejoice in this new creation, your church that you've brought into being through Jesus, your Son. And we rejoice that the day is coming soon when Jesus will return and the kingdom of this world will become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ. Praise and glory, wisdom and thanks, honor and glory and strength be to you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever. As we are here in your presence, Father, we confess to you our sins of thought, word, and action. Thank you for your promise that if we confess our sins, you are faithful and just and will forgive us and cleanse us from all that is wrong. Glory be to you, Father. Please strengthen and bless us. May we be united in unity and purpose and deed in your Son by the ministry of your Holy Spirit among us. Move in power, Lord, today. Enable us to worship you in spirit and in truth and to know your presence very much among us. Be glorified. Please speak to us in power by your word and change us by it. May we engage effectively with you in prayer. And may you delight in our praises. We bring all our prayers, we commit this time to you, Lord, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Savior, and we continue in the prayer he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, and the power and the glory forever. Amen. So Catherine's going to come now and read our Bible reading from Revelation 11. Thank you.
The reading this morning is from Revelation chapter 11. Verses 15 to 19, and can be found on page 1241 in the Pew Bible. The seventh angel sounded his trumpet, and there were loud voices in heaven which said, "The kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Messiah, and he will reign forever and ever." And the 24 elders who were seated on their thrones before God fell on their faces and worshipped God, saying, "We give thanks to you, Lord God Almighty, the one who is and who was, because you have taken your great power and have begun to reign. The nations were angry, and your wrath has come. The time has come for judging the dead and for rewarding your servants, the prophets, and your people who revere your name, both great and small, and for those and for destroying those who destroy the earth. Then God's temple in heaven was opened, and within his temple was seen the Ark of his covenant. And there came flashes of lightning, rumblings, peals of thunder, an earthquake, and a severe hailstorm. Amen.
Going to listen now to the Hallelujah Chorus, Hallelujah from Messiah by George Frederick Handel. We'll remain seated. I know that in the concert hall people stand, but we don't need to do it. We can sit and worship the Lord together as we watch the images on the screen that Joe's put together, and it fits so well with our theme. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah.
Let us pray. Lord, as we turn to this, your word here, this glorious word, solemn word, please speak to us. We open our hearts to you now. Direct me in my speaking and us in our hearing and responding, and may you be glorified and worshipped. Change our perspective and our hearts, and fill our hearts with love for you and longing for you, and fill us with your Spirit, we pray. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. So today we reach the end. It's not the end of Revelation, but it's the end in terms of what's been depicted here, the end of all things. The seven trumpet sounds, and it's the end to all the warnings of the previous six trumpets. Remember, they were designed to bring people back to the God who made them and who alone can save them. Sadly, we saw at the end of chapter 9, that wasn't happening. People kept on in their own way. I did it my way. Worshipping things that are not God. Carrying on in their sin. Through it all, we saw that the people of God have been protected, kept safe, sealed. Doesn't mean they don't share in the effects of this fallen world, but these particular partial judgments did not harm them, and they are kept for as long as God has work for us to do here. The sixth trumpet sounded at the end of chapter 9, and of course we had the interlude in chapter 10, chapter 11, first half. And that focused on the mission of the church. So it moved from these warnings to the world to focus on the church, with this emphasis on this little scroll and its sweetness and bitterness that had to be communicated by John, and then onto these two witnesses, faithful witnesses, a picture of the church through this age, into the intensification of evil at the end, the persecution and much martyrdom until the full number of the martyrs comes in at the end there. It looks as if the church is defeated as these witnesses have faithfully proclaimed Jesus, but it's not. Resurrection awaits, and we have that lovely picture of them going up to heaven. When Jesus returns, the dead in Christ will rise. Those who are still alive believing in Christ will be caught up with them in the air in the clouds to meet him, and will be with the Lord forever. For the rest of the mankind, we saw that just at the end there of chapter, but we were looking at chapter 11 last week, verses 13. Terror and unavoidable acknowledgement that God is indeed God for those who have rejected Christ. Now the seventh trumpet sounds. It is the third woe. It's quite strange. We'll see why that is. The fifth and sixth trumpets were the first and second woes. This is the third one. And as the trumpet sounds, this is big stuff today. As the seventh trumpet sounds, God's kingdom comes. That's our first heading. God's kingdom comes. Listen to verse 15 again. The seventh angel sounded his trumpet, and there were loud voices in heaven which said, "The kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ, and he will reign forever and ever." Isn't that just wonderful? All heaven powerfully and clearly declares this reality, this fulfillment. This coming of all that we've longed for, all that God has been working towards, it's so great, it's hard to know how to describe this. But here's another reading from 1 Corinthians 15, that great chapter about the resurrection. Paul says, "For as in Adam all die, so in Christ all will be made alive, but each in their own turn, Christ the first fruits. Then when he comes, those who belong to him, they will be raised. Then the end will come when he hands over the kingdom to God the Father after he has destroyed all dominion, authority, and power. For he must reign until he has put all his enemies under his feet, and the last enemy to be destroyed is death. That's what's happening here. The seventh trumpet sounds, and Jesus is handed over the completed kingdom to God the Father. Isn't that a great picture? His work is done. All that he achieved in the cross, and it was finished then, has now been worked through to the fulfillment that was certain. These verses in 1 Corinthians 15, we sometimes miss them. Hands over the kingdom to God the Father, having destroyed all dominion, power, and authority, and destroyed all enemies, and the last one is death. Marvelous. When Jesus began his ministry, he declared, "The time has come, the kingdom of God is near. Repent and believe the good news." The kingdom of God doesn't come here in Revelation. The kingdom of God comes in Jesus Christ. He is the perfect subject in the kingdom, perfectly obedient to his Father, and he's the perfect king, both sides. So as we trust in him, through his death and resurrection by which he dealt with our sins, only he could, he opened that living way back to God in himself. So as we trust in him, we are brought into the kingdom of God, born again into the kingdom of God, as Jesus said to Nicodemus. The kingdom of God, where God rules, where we are restored to that relationship with God we were made to have, living as subjects of our glorious King. And since Jesus' first coming, that kingdom has been growing, growing all over the world as people come to faith in him, bowing the knee to him, becoming part of God's family, the kingdom of God. Jesus is building his church throughout the world. That's where we are just now. The kingdom is here. It's growing, but we face such opposition from a world that rejects God. With Jesus, we face that opposition. Satan was defeated at the cross. Jesus did that then, took his teeth away, so to speak, but still has power, still active in this world. He was defeated there. He won't be defeated until we'll see that later in Revelation, that final defeat of Satan. But his doom is sealed. And in this spirit, we're in this spiritual battle. We wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against spiritual powers. Paul says, that's the devil and all his cronies. We are in this battle and this kingdom. The two kingdoms are in conflict. Even within us, we know that ourselves. But we are in the kingdom of God as those who profess Christ. That's why Paul says we have been translated out of the dominion of darkness, brought safe into the kingdom of the Son he loves, Jesus. So that kingdom is growing. Jesus taught us to pray in the Lord's Prayer, "Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven." And when this seventh trumpet sounds, that prayer is completely answered. Hallelujah, indeed. The process of the kingdom of God extending is completed. The kingdom of this world, just the one, it's interesting, not the kingdoms, the kingdom of this world, under the prince of this world, the devil. The kingdom of this world has become the kingdom of the Lord and of his Christ. We heard that marvelous hallelujah chorus. Significantly, verse 15 of chapter 11, you heard it there, takes its place along with a couple of verses from Revelation 19 to form the hallelujah chorus. Words. Handel apparently would often be found in tears as he composed Messiah. You can understand that, can't you? Such a profound work. It never cloys. It lasts. It's reported that he said when he wrote the completed the hallelujah chorus, "I did think I saw all heaven before me." And that's what we have in the seventh trumpet. Derek Newton says, God's plan for the completion of history is complete. All the enemies of the kingdom have been defeated, so God takes back the rule of this kingdom that previously he had permitted Satan to have. The world systems that persecuted the church here have now been defeated and replaced. The kingdom of this world has become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ. Messiah also insightfully includes, just before the Hallelujah chorus, verses from Psalm 2. And that psalm, why do the nations rage? People get together, conspire against the Lord and his Christ. It's the same reference there that we have in these words. The kingdoms of this world conspire against him, but God sends his Son there in Psalm 2, who is the one who will rule and over the whole world in perfect justice, judgment, and grace. And that process Psalm 2 speaks about, that messianic psalm, is now complete as we see this, hear the seventh trumpet sounding. The kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ. So let me ask you, how are you responding to this today so far? Does it lift your hearts and minds to another realm altogether? I hope so. Doesn't it change our perspective from being bound in the here and now with all our challenges and responsibilities and hopes and fears, loves, concerns? It lifts us, doesn't it? And that's what Revelation is designed to do, because this is the truth. This is eternity breaking in here. The reality of it all, isn't that glorious this Sunday morning? Sun shining today here in Hawick, in this world, to know this day is certain. How should we respond? Well, the next verse tells us his church worships, God's church worships. The 24 elders who were seated on their thrones before God fell on their faces and worshipped God. Here are the 24 elders in the throne room of heaven. We've met them before in Revelation. They represent the glorified church in heaven. They fall full length before God and worship him. That's the right response, isn't it? We were made to worship God. I remember realizing that many years ago when I'd recently come to faith in Jesus. I was at a conference and we were singing that chorus based on Revelation 4:11. Thou art worthy, thou art worthy, thou art worthy, O Lord, for you've created all things. And it goes on to say, you have created all things, and for your pleasure they were created. Thou art worthy, O Lord, for your pleasure they were created. For his pleasure I was created. So we're made to do, restored in Jesus, to worship the Father. That's what we're for, to worship and love and serve the Lord. When we try and look for that elsewhere, we can't find it. That's what we're for. In the film Chariots of Fire, Eric Liddell says, whether he said it in real life or not, I don't know, but it's true to him, I think. Speaking to Jenny, you know, God made me for a purpose. He's made me for China, for the mission field. But he's also, God made me fast. And when I run, I feel his pleasure. Isn't that lovely? We were made to worship the Lord in all we are and do, for his glory and pleasure, because he made us for himself. And our hearts are restless till they find their rest in him. So let's look at the church's worship here, which is in response, what it is in response to. Well, first of all, they worship God for who he is. We give thanks to you, Lord God Almighty, the one who is and who was. Who is and who was. That's slightly different to how God's described back in Revelation chapter 1, verse 8. It says, I am the Alpha and the Omega. We had the signs there on the screen during the Hallelujah chorus. I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty. Do you spot the difference? Like these puzzles you have with the two pictures, with the subtle differences between the two? What's missed out? Who is to come? The future component, who is to come, is not there when the seventh trumpet sounds. That's because all is present now forever. We give thanks to Lord God Almighty, the one who is and who was. They worship God for who he is, but they also worship God, and this is striking and exhilarating, because of his complete victory and his being fully in charge of everything now and forever. You have taken your great power and have begun to reign. I'm told, I read yesterday that Charles Jennens, who very skillfully put the words of Messiah together, the Handel then wrote the score for all from Scripture. Part of his reason for doing so was to show that deism was wrong. It's quite interesting. Deism is thought that God, like a kind of watchmaker, wound up the universe and let it go and is not involved anymore. He's not involved in his creation. He's left it to go its own ways like an absentee landlord. So there's no point in asking him to do things. We have to do them ourselves. And you see that. Some sectors of the church, that kind of thinking. But we are not deists, we are theists. We believe in the living God who is active, who does things, who's working out his purposes and bringing things to an end goal, as you see today in this passage. Look at him here. You have taken your great power. The verb used there for taken indicates that it's something that's happened that lasts, that has a continuous, it's a perfect. You have taken your great power. That's it. He now has taken that power permanently. There's no threat, there's no change, there's no opposition. That is it. He's taken it. But you've taken your great power. Great power, that's what God has. And then have begun to reign. That's a decisive verb, something that he's done. He's triumphed. He's on the throne. You have begun to reign, and he's on his throne. You have taken your great power and begun to reign. Praise God. So the glorified church worship God for his victory over all evil and all sin, because he's taken his great power and has begun to reign. From their perspective, it is done. There is robustness in this, that the worship is for him dealing with all that was opposed to him, all evil and sin, and those who oppose him have been dealt with, and they worship God for that. That's a challenge to us. There's robustness and depth and reality in that. Our God is a holy God. God who saves, holy God, you've taken your great power and begun to reign. What of our worship? What of our worship? As we're here in Hawick today, still in this world, what is our worship like? What is your worship like? What's your experience of engaging together in worship, or indeed on your own? Do you worship him in the full assurance that everything he does is right? There's no darkness in him at all. He is working his purposes out. Do you worship him in the full assurance that he is working in ways we don't even see, in his grace to draw people to himself, and they will be his forever? Do you worship him in the full assurance in this broken, messed up world that he is still in charge? He's at work in history in his perfect justice and mercy. We worship him. May the Holy Spirit take our worship here in Teviot and on into the Union. May he take hold of us. May your the worship you offer in me and all of us together corporately, and there's power and strength in that togetherness and worship. May it be deep and real and engage with who God really is. All he does with love and trust. And may the reality of our worship glorify God and bring pleasure to him. And may those who come among us know that God is truly among us, that we are worshiping a present God, that this is real. As the seventh trumpet sounds, God has begun to reign. What will that mean for the people of the world? Well, it means that God judges and saves. And this is this robustness again, you see. We see in verse 18 that the elders worship God for his judgment and his salvation. He judges and saves, our third heading. God's kingdom comes, his church worships, he judges and saves. Verse 18 begins, "The nations were angry, and your wrath has come. The time has come for judging the dead." And it ends that verse, "The time has come for destroying those who destroy the earth." The verse has bookends of judgment, verse 18. Notice that this judgment is completely just. God is not arbitrary in his wrath. He is not capricious. He doesn't fly off the handle when he feels like it because he can. His judgment, his wrath, is his settled, steady hatred of all that is wrong, all sin, all evil, hatred in his holiness of that. See how the punishment fits the crime. The nations were angry, and your wrath has come. The time has come for destroying those who destroy the earth. The punishment fits the crime. Jesus himself said, Mark 8:38, "If anyone is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, the Son of Man will be ashamed of them when he comes in his Father's glory with the holy angels." Jesus will treat people exactly as they have treated him. We see here again the anger of the nations against God. Psalm 2 spoke of that. Why do the nations rage, unite so furiously together against the Lord and his Christ? This opposition to the one who made them, it's rebellion, it's sin. The refusal to recognize God as God. And we see those who destroy the earth, not just in terms of the environment, the kind of fabric of the world, but people. Life itself, our humanness, relationships, health, hope, purpose, whatever it may be, destroyed by the sinfulness of human beings. The time is coming when God's wrath will come, when all that destroys the earth will be destroyed. And that is a cause for worship. You see the robustness? This verse 18 is part of the song of the elders. "We give thanks to you, Lord God Almighty, the one who is and who was, because you have taken your great power and begun to reign." And the same song goes on. "The nations were angry. Your wrath has come. The time has come for judging the dead." So on. When the seventh trumpet sounds, the time has come for judgment. This is Kairos time. The time has come, the right time, the ripe time. The time is ripe. God has stayed his hand in his patience and grace in this day of grace, but now judgment falls. The warning trumpets have sounded. Now the seventh trumpet sounds, and the door is shut, like the door of the ark of Noah's ark was closed, like the door was closed at the end of that parable of the foolish, wise and foolish virgins. They were too late. The door was closed. Total justice comes. It's a good thing. We shy away from it in our culture, don't we? But strangely enough, our culture also shows that it is right. So you get films like the Terminator or Jack Reacher series. Very violent. But what's happening there? The baddies are dealt with, and the goodies walk away quite free and untouched by anyone, by the authorities or whatever. It shows that we know there is need for justice. That's vigilantism, of course. That's not God's perfect justice. It's revenge and all these kind of things. But it does show what we really think and know, that there is a need for justice and judgment. There is a judgment to come. The Apostle Paul says, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. He says, sin pays a price, death. And Jesus says in John 3:16 that if it weren't for him coming, all would perish. In the light of that, how amazing and deep is the grace of God. For salvation is totally just. You know that, don't you? When Jesus died on the cross, he took that just punishment on himself for the horror of our sin. And he died for it. He took it away. We bear it no more. We're forgiven and free. So Paul can say, Romans 3, God did this to demonstrate his justice at the present time, so as to be just and the one who justifies the one who trusts in Jesus. Justice is satisfied in the cross, our salvation. Justice brings salvation in Jesus. So in the center of verse 18, we've got the bookends of judgment, but in the middle we've got salvation. Time has come for judging the dead and for rewarding your servants, the prophets, and your people who revere your name, both great and small. They're described in three ways. Well, in my translation it seems just two categories here. Have you got an older NIV there, Ashley? Can I just borrow it a minute? Could you just check something? Should have checked this before, but thank you. Double check. Yes, that's right. The time has come for judging the dead and for rewarding your servants, the prophets, and your saints, and those who revere your name. Thank you. The new translation has taken the saints out, but three categories, but it's all the same group. It's believers in Christ. They are prophets. They prophesy. They testify faithfully to Jesus. That's us. They worship God. They are saints. They are forgiven and made holy by the blood of Jesus, and they are those who worship God in reverence, whether they're in obscurity in the public eye, rich or poor, ordinary or privileged, great or small. And they have a reward, the song says. What is that reward? It is a reward due to Jesus, because we're in Jesus, all by his grace, all undeserved. What is that reward? They will be with God forever and see his glory. I think this is just lovely. Jesus at the end of John 17 in his prayer before he went to the cross prayed this: I want, Father, I want those you have given me to be with me where I am and to see my glory, the glory you have given me because you loved me before the creation of the world. I want those you have given me to be with me where I am and to see my glory. That prayer is now answered as the seventh trumpet sounds. We will be with the Lord and see him in glory. There are other rewards the New Testament speaks about for believers who have served faithfully. But this is the reward for all believers, to be with him in glory. Our worship is most real when it gives a foretaste of that. Is that not so? Experienced that. I remember a friend came out of a worship service and said, if heaven's going to be even like that, you know, if that's a foretaste of heaven, I want to be there. So after the elders' robust and wonderful song of praise, just this bit at the end here, this verse 19, the heavenly temple is opened. Handel spoke about seeing heaven open. Well, the temple is opened and the Ark of the Covenant is seen. And if you know, the temple in Jerusalem had the inner sanctuary and the outer sanctuary. The Holy of Holies was shielded by this massive curtain. No one could go in except the high priest once a year with blood of animals to bring get forgiveness of the sins. He sprinkled that on the Ark and the Covenant atonement cover above it. But it was closed. No one could see it. No one could go in. But this is open for all to see here, this heavenly sanctuary. God is revealing his presence fully and completely. Faith gives way to sight, you could say, in the presence of his people here. And it also speaks of that forgiveness, that reward through the blood of Jesus. When he died, the temple of the curtain was torn in two from top to bottom. So the way into God was opened up. Here it's fully open. The work is done. So there's reward here. There's that salvation fulfilled. But there's also judgment, because we have these signs of judgment too. Flashings of lightning, rumblings, peals of thunder, an earthquake, and a severe hailstorm. So right at the end of this reading, once again, we see in this picture of the Ark of the Covenant displayed, the revelation of God and his glory. But this last day brings judgment and salvation, reward to those who have waited for Christ. He judges and saves as he takes his great power and reigns. So the seventh trumpet is sounded. God's kingdom comes. Praise God for that. Hallelujah. His church worships, and he judges and saves. May we worship this God in his glory, his holiness, his saving power, in his holiness, justice. Amen. May God bless his word to our hearts. I'm going to sing now a song, Longing for That Day to Come. How long? Stuart Townend.
We have sung our songs of victory. We have prayed to you for rain. We have cried for your compassion to renew the land again. Now we're standing in your presence, more hungry than before. Now we're on your steps of mercy, and we're knocking at your door. How long before you drench the barren land? How long before we see your righteous hand? How long before your name is lifted high? How long before the weeping turns to songs of joy? Lord, we know your heart is broken by the evil that you see, and you stayed your hand of judgment, for you planned to set man free. But the land is still in darkness, and we fled from what is right. We have failed the silent children who have never seen the light. How long before you drench the barren land? How long before we see your righteous hand? How long before your name is lifted high? How long before the weeping turns to song?
Let's pray. Lord God Almighty, our loving Heavenly Father, with your church in heaven, we worship you, who was and is to come. We thank you that you are working out your purposes of justice and grace here on earth, and the day will surely come when your Son returns. Your kingdom will come on earth as it is in heaven. Your radiance, your light, your fragrance will fill everything. You will bring perfect judgment on all sin and evil, and on Satan and all evil powers and authorities in the heavenly places. And you will defeat and replace all world systems that oppose you and your ways and your church. What a day that will be. Until then, we worship you, knowing your Spirit's presence, holding on to your sure promises, and resting in your covenant faithfulness. May the hope we have of being with you forever and seeing you face to face, seeing your glory, cause us to live holy lives and love and serve you wholeheartedly now. Your kingdom come. Come, Lord Jesus. Lord, we long for you to renew your church by your Holy Spirit. Quicken us in our spiritual life individually and together, we pray. As we look ahead to the Revive Scotland mission in May, we ask you to make us prayerful as we prepare. May that be so in unity, together among all the churches in this town and district, so that when the actual week comes, we are ready together as your church. We thank you for the victory you have won, Lord Jesus, over the devil, but we know he is still active. May the strong man be bound so his possessions can be taken. May many come to faith in Jesus in coming months and at the mission itself, and may they be helped to grow in discipleship afterwards for your glory and the blessing of your church and your world. Father, as we think of your kingdom coming, we pray for this world and all its need. We pray for Russia. It is difficult to know what is going on there, but we pray for you to be at work, especially through those who belong to Jesus. Be at work, Lord, in your truth, justice, and grace in the Kremlin and in President Putin. As we hear of the death in prison of Alexei Navalny, who was a critic of the government, we ask that the truth regarding his death will be known. May the work of those who have taken up his cause be of benefit to Russia, and may those who speak the truth be heard and protected for the sake of what is right. We pray for comfort for the family of Alexei and for justice and peace in that nation. We continue to pray too for Ukraine, for a just and peaceful outcome. May peacemakers arise who sow in peace, producing a harvest of righteousness. And for Israel, Gaza, again, Lord, we ask for a just and lasting peace to be forged. Lord God, who reconciled sinners to himself in Jesus, may there be costly reconciliation somehow in these places. If that is possible, use your people. To that end, we pray. Father, we pray for the overseas care workers brought over here in recent months by a local agency, which has now lost its ability to sponsor overseas workers, exposing them to potential deportation, which would leave a gap in care provision. Lord, in your mercy, may alternative sponsors be found. May these people and their families living here in Hawick, receiving our hospitality, may they be treated well and fairly and know your compassion and grace. In Jesus Christ, your Son. Father, we ask for your comfort for those who grieve the loss of a loved one today. Move in them by your grace, we pray. And we think of church up at Burnfoot there with the sudden death of Ron Swinton, one of their elders. Your comfort, Lord, for all those who mourn, we pray. We think of those who are unwell in body or mind. We name them before you, Father. Ask your healing power to be at work in them. We pray particularly for those who know their days on earth are drawing to a close. If they are believers in Christ, strengthen their faith by your grace, we pray. And if they are not, by your grace, may they be brought to a firm trust in Jesus Christ as their Savior and Lord. And now, Father, in a moment of quiet, we bring our personal concerns to you. Lord, hear all our prayers as we bring them in Jesus' name. Amen. So we close the service with, "There is a higher throne." Let's say the grace to one another. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forevermore. Amen.